Mortgage tips for brand new buyers. How about mortgage tips for all buyers? Good day, everybody. I am Connor McIver, SCVnest.com, Remax's of Gateway, Remax Gateway, Paris 911 real estate team. Now, located in Santa Clarita Valley, longest running real estate show and broadcast. We're coming to you live from the back of the Best Buy Shopping Center, awaiting Paris to run in. She does have an appointment with one of the managers here at a local business, speaking about real estate on his time and at his location, which actually works very, very well. But today we're going to talk about some of the things that real estate buyers should be looking for with regard to mortgages. Now, of course, we're not lenders. We are realtors, but we love to be that first point of contact for you and yours when it comes to real estate. Now, looking through the World Wide Web and then going back to our own resources with buyers, there are a lot of items out there that I think do impact real estate buyers when it comes to purchasing real estate as far as the loan is concerned. Now, understand, a real estate buyer, if you're not aware of the process, there are closing costs. These are fees that are on top of the actual house price. There are lots of ways to get those handled. You can write a check, you can pay cash in some circumstances, or get them financed into the deal, or have the seller credit you the amount for those costs. Lots of different ways to approach it. The tenacity, if you will, of your real estate agent, I think, is going to help a lot in getting those fees taken care of in some way, shape, or form. So you want to ask about that. But talking about closing costs, one of those things, there's three things. You're part of title insurance, you're part of escrow. Those two items are typically set by sales price. So when you are purchasing residential real estate, usually there's not much movement from one escrow company to another escrow company, one title company to another title company. And at the end of the day, typically that's a seller choice anyway. Usually the seller via their real estate agent is going to choose those two services. The wild card in the game, and the other one that hasn't been mentioned yet, at least directly, is being associated with closing costs, lender. Mortgage brokers, lenders, banks, credit unions, the place where you're going to borrow your money to purchase the residential real estate. Cool. Those fees, that part of the closing cost, a little bit of a wild card, so you want to make sure that you're getting a fair deal. And besides fair, you want to make sure that with a fair deal, that's going to bring into value a customer service, being available, closing on time, adhering to all the compliance dates within the escrow, just to make sure that you're not hung out monetarily and having to pay extra in fees, like at the end of escrow, if the lender isn't prepared or hasn't been really paying attention to the file, you could be charged a per diem fee, which means every day late in closing, you have to pay extra money. Watch out for that. Very important to make sure that you are working with somebody that is taken good care of. Let's get into this. We have a few things to cover. Credit score, very important. It's important that you also know yours. A couple of resources out there. You have to be careful of those free ones, but again, it is a location online you can go. Typically, what happens is your information, once you give it up on these online systems, lots of times that data is sold to different organizations, people that would be interested in your credit score, i.e. lenders, i.e. credit card companies, i.e. large box chain stores or large supermarkets or large other types of shopping businesses that have credit cards built in. Also, maybe some of the locals around are paying for that data. Be careful with that when you go on there. The next best resource, one that will keep your personal information protected, the local lender. We do refer people to our lender out here. We have several that we work with, and we do explain to them, listen, give them all your information. The lender will give you copies of your credit reports, and then you'll be able to at least have that in your hot little hand. Is it going to change from the online systems? No, because they're all going to be accessing the three bureaus. Online systems sometimes only do one or two. Something else to watch out for. But the lender credit pull is going to be all of the bureaus, and there's three of them, and that way you'll be able to get your average and find out where you are currently. So you want to check. FICO scores are going to impact what your interest rate's going to be, and if, in fact, you can even borrow money to get a loan. Now, let's get into the next field here with lenders. Estimate how much can be borrowed. Now, there's a difference. A lender, if they're doing their job, they're going to take more than a day to put all your information into a computer system and giving you something called an automated approval. That's going to be a very, very solid form of approval. Now, within a few minutes, of course, any lender talking to any client over the telephone, they'll be able to give you some insight as to what they believe the estimate is of what you can afford. But to do a full approval is going to take more time than that. When you do contact that lender, they will give you those numbers, how long it's going to take. They might say something like, hey, Jack, if your name's Jack, hey, Jack, and it's going to take you 6 days for us to get you a full approval. These are the documents we need. Whenever they say this, bringing us into the next point, gather the documents. Whenever they say this, you don't want to be harassed too much with regard to documents. There are certain items the lender does have to see. And it's not just the lender, it's other people involved, the investor, if in fact they're going to be using somebody else to give you the money. And this is kind of where the breakdown comes. If you're using a mainline bank, a lot of times those loans are going to be sold on the secondary market. If you're using a credit union, a lot of times those loans, when you get a loan from them, it's going to stay with the credit union. If you use a mortgage broker, more than likely those will be sold on the secondary market as well. So you might start out having ING being your lender via mortgage broker, and then Bank of America buys your loan. Now all of a sudden, Bank of America is known as the servicer. So you start getting bills from them. All this stuff after escrow closes, you're notified of in writing. Just pay attention if, in fact, you don't get any kind of bill from a mortgage company after escrow closes. Whenever that first payment was due, if you don't have any information or you don't have anything in mail or you don't recall where you need to make your payment to, be wary. Reach out to that lender. Say, hey, Bill, I don't have a bill yet for my mortgage, and you said my payment was due September 1st. I don't have anything. They'll be able to research that, so check it out. But all these documents, copies of credit reports, whatever it may be, your employment verification paperwork, because they're going to ask if you are employed and if you are going to need that employment to be able to secure a loan on residential real estate, they're going to want verification from your employer. Yeah, Sammy does have a job. He's been here 6 years. He's in good standing, and so on. You're going to want tax returns as well. So all of these documents save. So I'd create a folder, financial documents, on your desktop, and within that folder, I would put taxes. I would put paycheck stubs. I would put verification of employment. Whatever those items the lender needs, because throughout that process, folks, they're going to need new ones. So let's say you have a bank statement today from your checking account showing a particular amount of money. On that statement, it's going to also show a date that was produced. The next month, if you're getting close to closing, a month later, that lender is going to say, hey, I need a new bank statement. I need a new paycheck stub. I need new this, new that. It makes it a lot easier just in case everything breaks down. Let's say you and the seller come to an area of disagreement where you're not choosing to move forward with the purchase of the residence and they're not helping you move forward with the purchase of the residence, or something changed, then at least you have all those documents that you can start the process over without too much of a pain point or having to go to this other lender. Maybe they're the ones that weren't performing. Now all of a sudden you're kind of like, ugh, now I got to go back to them. And it's difficult to call them, right? You go to your lender and say, hey, Frank, listen, I'm not going to use you anymore because you really upset me and I think you're taking advantage of me. I'm going to go to this other lender. Would you mind sending me all my paperwork? Well, you know, it's something you could ask, but it's not easy. So save those docs on your desktop or in the cloud, but retain everything just so you have it, every piece of paper, and it will help. And of course, after the real estate transaction, a couple different ways. We have all of our clients' information and the entire file scanned onto basically a CD, and then they have that information after. So that's something to be aware of. All right. So we have the docs pre-approved. We did talk a little bit about that. And getting pre-approved, again, is via a letter. And that letter is going to be a particular amount. Like I said earlier, you know, the estimation of what you can afford. Maybe your pre-approval comes back at $750,000. Maybe when you look at that payment, though, it's uncomfortable. Maybe you don't want to go there. So ultimately, maybe you might be looking $600,000 or less. So you let your agent know that. And then those pre-approval letters that follow are going to each be matching the prices that you're writing offers for. So maybe you find something at $580,000. and you look at the value with your realtor and you find out that that 580 house is only really worth 560, which does happen. So then you don't want that seller to see a pre-approval letter at 750 because you're discounting them 20,000, even though on paper that looks like where it needs to be. There's no point in letting them see that you're qualified for more. So each approval letter, we tell this to our sellers. That's what buyers typically will do if they're working with a savvy real estate agent. You're not going to see their full approval amount. So if they're undercutting you 20 grand, don't think that's the last part of the deal and it's not going to work out. That's where negotiation happens. And if the seller wants that 580, then they counter back with the 580. Say, well, we're only going to take 580. We've only been on the market 10 minutes. We're only going to take what we're asking for the property. These are the ways negotiation works, and it shouldn't be offensive. So you have that pre-approved, so you have that letter. And again, that lender needs to make themselves available to you so you're able to have your agent or you yourself reach out to them and get new approval letters at different amounts. Very important. All right, those closing costs, that lender's going to cover that. And this is another tip. The lender's going to cover those closing costs. They'll be able to get you a number. It's going to be your part of escrow, your part of title, and their fee. And they will show you that on something called a good faith estimate. And the good faith estimate is going to be based on the interest rate today. You know, interest rates do fluctuate up and down a little bit every week. And sometimes the Fed gets involved and they go up substantially or come down substantially. Something to watch out for. But again, all the other numbers in the good faith estimate besides interest rates should relatively be close to how they're going to end up at the very end when you do actually get loan documents and you're looking at this and you're having the nice lady explain it to you, or nice man explain it to you when they're going over all the loan documents with you, because they will go down through each and every document and they will explain to you, this is how you're being charged, this is how much it is, this is how long the loan is, this is the interest rate on the loan. Anything that comes up during that process that like throws a flag or is a red flag to you, don't worry, stop. Say, excuse me, miss, mister, I talked with the lender, this doesn't make sense. This isn't what I was promised. I have it in writing. We need to get them on the phone before we proceed. That's something that you can do as a real estate buyer, so don't be scared. But looking at those closing costs on a good faith estimate, having an actual printed out version for verification, not a bad idea. And finally, the last tip, and I also say this about real estate agents, shop around. If you're a real estate buyer, you're not paying my fee. I don't get paid by you. I get compensated by the seller. So my services to you are free. However, on the other side of the coin, you are paying the lender, you are paying escrow, you are paying title. Escrow and title are typically selected by the seller, so the lender's the thing. You want to go ahead and find a good one. Now, you always come, we sit down with new buyers all the time and even veteran buyers in our offices. We have a game crash course on real estate, developing a game plan, and we'll sit there and we'll explain to you how real estate actually works and give you some suggestions on lenders. And we also base it on employment. If you happen to be working for the motion picture industry, use their credit union. We talk about how that works and the best way to take advantage of that process and getting your best deal. Well, a police officer, again, a police federal credit union, fireman's credit union. See? So it works. We sit there, we explain it, we talk about the process, and we help. I'm Connor McIver. Those are a few tips for you first-time buyers and veteran buyers out there with regard to mortgages. And again, we are realtors, not lenders, but we would love to be your first stop in the entire real estate process, even if you're doing it again multiple times in your life. Reach out to us when you're ready, scvnest.com. I'm Connor with Honor. Thanks for listening to Housing Radio. .com. Check us out online, of course. Longest reigning real estate broadcast for Santa Clarita and Greater Los Angeles cities. Thank you so much. Be safe. Call me. I'll be here. Over and out.